Hello friends, in this lecture we will see types of learning. So in previous lecture we have seen that what is meant by machine learning. So if machine learning is there, so what are the different types of learnings are there? Okay, so these are basically four types of learning. First one is supervised learning. Second is unsupervised learning. Third is semi-supervised learning. And fourth one is reinforcement learning. Now we will see one by one in detail. First thing is supervised learning. So what is supervised learning? So as its name indicates, it is in the presence of some supervisor as a teacher, we can say. So basically, supervised learning is a learning in which we teach or train the machine using data which is well labeled. That means some data is already tagged with correct answer. Okay, so the thing is, suppose we are having large amount of data. So whenever we are performing supervised learning or whenever we are using any algorithm, so that algorithms are based on the types of learning only. So there are some data which is already tagged with the correct answer. Like suppose we are having some pictures, and in that picture some cats and dogs are present. So 3 number of cats and 4 number of dogs are present there. So that cats are labeled as a name with cat. Dogs are labeled with name as a dog. Okay, so by using that, what it means, so these data are already labeled. Okay, so whenever you come up with new cat or new dog, and if you are giving that cat or dog as an input to your algorithm, so that will be able to understand whether it is cat or dog, because we have already explained the features or the sizes or the colors or their shapes. These are some features of cats and dogs. So these features are already we have explained to the algorithm and we have labeled according to it. So this kind of learning is known as supervised learning. So after that, the machine is provided with a new set of examples so that supervised learning algorithm analyzes the training data and produces a correct outcome from labeled data. Okay, so the thing is, we will see one example. For example, basket filled with different kinds of fruits. Okay, so this is one picture of supervised learning. From this picture, we will be having some idea about it. Okay, so the thing is, We are having a basket filled with fruits. We can say that we are having some apples and we are having some bananas in the basket. So apple is having red color, banana is having yellow color. So the size of apple, size of banana is totally different. Then see, apple is having some leaves on it. Banana will not have any leaf on it. So these are some features, like apple is round in shape and banana is having different shape. Okay, so here algorithm it is there, and when we are teaching the algorithm that how to recognize the apple or banana, so we are providing some different features to the machine learning algorithm. Whenever a thing with these features, these in the sense, Suppose a thing with round in shape, red in color, having some leaves on it, it comes in front of you, you have to recognize it as an apple. Okay. And whenever a thing with yellow in color and somewhat long in shape and there is no leaf on it, so you have to recognize it as a banana. So these are some features which we have already explained to the machine learning algorithm. Okay, for that, or to make him learn, we have to give some apples and some bananas as an example before going to task. Like whenever we are teaching the algorithm that this is apple and this is banana, you have to take some examples. Like you have to take 4 to 5 apples and you have to put in front of the machine learning algorithm. Like maybe there are round in shape some fruits are there, but that should not be apple. It is also possible. So whenever you have to recognize the apple, you have to come with these three features, like red in color, round in shape, and having some leaves on it. So this is the, or these are some features of recognizing apple. So it is also possible that basket may contains another fruit in spite of apple and banana. Okay, so it is also possible. So what we have to do is we have to tell learning algorithm that these are the three features, and what you have to do is whenever you see these three features in one fruit or one thing, what you have to do is you have to recognize it as an apple. Okay. So in first diagram, the person is showing one image to the algorithm and asking whether it is banana or not. Okay, or person is telling actually to the algorithm that this is not banana. And in second image, person is telling algorithm that these are apples. So these things, what we can say it as a input. We are giving input to the learning algorithm. And after giving a lot of learning things, or after giving a lot of experiences to the learning algorithm, when we ask actually that suppose we have given 4 apples or 5 apples and 10 bananas to it, and after that whenever I am going with 11th number of banana and I am going to ask that recognize this whether it is apple or banana, so that time learning algorithm will check the things, it will check all the features of that thing, whatever coming in front of him, and as per the past experiences given to him, or as per the data set given or provided to him, on the basis of that, algorithm will recognize that this is banana. So this is called as supervised learning. So whenever we have to go with something to the learning algorithm, that something should be labeled, okay? So that whenever we are coming with the labeled kind of data in front of machine learning algorithm, so that kind of thing is known as supervised learning, okay? Second thing is, again, the supervised learning can be classified into 2 categories of algorithm. First one is classification and second one is regression, okay? So the classification problem is when the output variable is category such as red or blue. So what is this thing? Suppose you have given number of balls in a basket. Some balls are red in color and some balls are blue in color. Okay. So when, now the thing is, we are giving label to our data. We are having large number of data. Suppose we are having 40 red color balls and 50 blue color balls. So we are having a large amount of data here. We are labeling that data, like the thing which is having red color, that are red color balls. The thing we are having blue colors, that are the blue color balls. What it means? So it means that the data is labeled kind of data. Now the thing is, whenever, what is mean by classification problems? So suppose one algorithm asks you to classify this data, or to differentiate between it. So at that time, we are solving classification type of problem. And the regression is, regression also contains, or regression problems are also known as supervised kind of learning, because the data present in it also labeled kind of data, but that output is continuous type of output. Means it is not having large amount of data. It is having only one real value. such as any person's weight or number of dollars present with you. So these are the things comes with regression type of problems. Actually, these are the problems associated with supervised learning. So for everything, we are having some algorithm in our syllabus. We'll see one by one. Okay. So the next thing is unsupervised learning. So what is unsupervised learning? Unsupervised learning comes with, as we can say, supervised comes with labeled data. Definitely unsupervised data should come with unlabeled data. So this is the training of machine using information that is neither classified nor labeled and allowing algorithm to act on that information without guidance. Okay, so here is a task of machine to group unsorted information according to similarities, patterns, and differences without any prior training of data. Okay. So unlike supervised learning, there is no teacher provided. That means no training will be given to the machine. Therefore, machine is restricted to find the hidden structure in unlabeled data by himself. Okay. Like suppose we will consider the example of red and blue balls only. We have given a basket with 40 red balls and 50 blue balls. Okay. So in unsupervised learning, there is no learning before going to ask some questions to the algorithm. Okay. What it means, we are not classifying the data. We are not labeling the data. We are not making red color as a red balls and blue color as a blue balls. Simply, we are throwing all these things in front of algorithm. Okay. Now, what algorithm has to do? Algorithm has to act on the information without guidance. What it means, algorithm only knows that these are some data sets provided to me and I don't know anything about this and still I have to classify the data. Okay. So, what he has to do? He has to consider randomly one ball from it and the balls near to him, he has to consider it as a red. Okay. What I said, 40 red balls are there and 50 blue balls are there. So all these in 90 balls, any algorithm which is working on unsupervised learning, that means unlabeled data. So what he has to consider? Any of the ball he has to pick and he has to consider that this might be red. Okay. And if this is red, the balls which are present near to these balls, this ball, that balls are red balls. And the balls which are far from this ball, we can consider it as a blue ball. So it is also possible that whatever two classifications this type of algorithms are doing, so that might be wrong also, because red ball group might consist of some blue ball group might consist of some red balls. So we can say that there is no 100% accuracy we can achieve with the unsupervised learning, but it is having its own applications also. So it is not the thing that if it is not classifying the data well, so it means that unsupervised learning is not of use with machine learning, because unsupervised learning is also having its own applications with it. Okay, so this is the basic thing about unsupervised learning. So we will take one example. Suppose in basket we are having different types of potatoes. Okay, so what the thing is, here in first example we have given the sample in which three types of potatoes are mixed with one another. And there is no label into it that black color potato are there, white color potato are there. Okay. So the thing is, what algorithm have to do? Algorithm have to pick one potato from it. And what he has to consider that potatoes present near this potato, we can say that these are white colored potato. Potatoes present in this distance, there we can say as these are red color potato or black color potato. And for this distance, we can consider that another type of portent. And by using this theory only, unsupervised learning will cluster them, or unsupervised learning will classify, we can say that unsupervised learning can classify these kinds of portent. So this is known as unsupervised learning. So this type of learning can be classified into two categories again. First one is clustering, and second one is association. So clustering problem is where you want to discover the inherent groups in data, such as grouping customers by purchasing behavior. Okay. So clustering is the thing which is very important. We are having a number of algorithms for it. We will see it one by one. Okay. So the clustering is the thing where we can say, like here example is given, grouping customers by purchasing behavior. Suppose we are having 10 numbers of customers, and according to their purchasing behavior, we have to cluster them. We are not classifying them, we are clustering them. Okay, because classification is not possible with unsupervised learning, because the data is not labeled data. Data is unlabeled. So classification means whenever the data is labeled and you can classify them 100%, then we can say that these are classified. So the classification problem comes with supervised learning. And for the same, we are having clustering in unsupervised learning, that when it comes with, suppose we are having 10 customers and they are having different behaviors while purchasing something. So the behavior they are having, on the basis of that, we are making clusters of them. Like the first cluster, we can say, these are the person making some bargaining. These are the person, these are not making bargaining. These are persons, they will not purchase the things like these. According to that, we will make clusters of the data, or clusters of the persons, we can say here, customers, we can say, likewise. Next one is association. An association rule learning problem is where you want to discover rules that describe large portions of your data, such as people that buy X also tend to buy Y. Like, we can say example, suppose three movies are there, M1, M2 and M3 movies, and two customers are there, X1 and X2. And we are making analysis that what is the association between X1 and X2. Okay. So if X1 is going to see or going to watch the movie M1, and he is giving rating, giving the rating for the movie M1 5, and X2 is also giving the rating 5. X1 is going for watch the movie M2 and giving the rating 5. And X2 is going to watch movie M2 giving rating 5. Now, X1 went to watch the movie M3 and given the rating 5. Now, X2 is not yet went to see the movie, but by using the association rule, what is the association between X1 and X2 is, X2 should definitely go to watch the movie and should definitely give the rating as a 5, because X1 is giving. Because X1 and X2 having some association between them, they are having same interest, that's why they are giving same types of ratings to the movies. So definitely X2 should go to watch the movie M3 and should definitely give ratings to that movie M3 as a 5. So this is called as association. So these are two types of problems associated with unsupervised learning actually. Okay. Next is, what are the basic differences between supervised learning and unsupervised learning? So here are some criteria, and on the basis of that we will differentiate supervised and unsupervised learning. First thing is input data. So supervised learning uses known and labeled data as input, and unsupervised learning uses unknown, that means unlabeled kind of data as input. Next one is computational complexity. So supervised learning is very complex and unsupervised learning is less computational complexity, because now the supervised learning is labeled. So whenever you are going to classify the data, we should expect 100% accuracy from it. Okay, in unsupervised, there is no labeled data. So whatever comes into that region, we are classifying or we are clustering the things according to that. So that is less complex. And as supervised learning is labeled data, we are expecting 100% accuracy from it. So that is some sort of complexity is there. Next one is real time. So it uses offline analysis. It uses real time analysis of data. Next one is number of classes. So in supervised learning, number of classes are known, and in unsupervised learning, number of classes are not known. Okay, so these are some criteria on the basis of what we can differentiate it. Next one is semi-supervised learning. So semi-supervised learning, it is a class of machine learning tasks and techniques that also make use of unlabeled data for training. Typically, a small amount of labeled data with large amount of unlabeled data. So many machine learning researchers have found that unlabeled data, when used in conjunction with small amount of labeled data, can produce considerable improvement in learning accuracy. Because before some time we have seen that that supervised learning contains some sort of complexity in it, and unsupervised learning is having less complexity. But in supervised learning, data is labeled. Here the data is unlabeled. So by mixing all these features, we can generate one more type of learning, that is semi-supervised, in which small amount of labeled data is there and large amount of unlabeled data is there. Now the thing is, whenever we are applying some algorithms onto it, as it is a combination of both type of learning, definitely it will improve the accuracy of the learning algorithm, because it contains all the things whatever we have seen in previous two types of learning. So it will improve the learning accuracy. So there are some practical applications of semi-supervised learning where it is used, because it is also having its own use or application, we can say. So speech analysis, since labeling of audio files is very intensive task, semi-supervised learning is very natural approach to solve this problem. Internet content classification, labeling each page is an impractical and unfeasible process, and thus uses semi-supervised learning algorithm. Even the Google search algorithm uses a variant of semi-supervised learning to rank the relevance of web pages for given query. Next one is protein sequence classification. Since DNA strands are typically very large in size, the rise of semi-supervised learning has been imminent in this field. So these are some applications we can say for semi-supervised learning. Likewise, we can have a large number of applications with us that will work on to the semi-supervised, because it gives somewhat more accuracy as compared with supervised and unsupervised learning. So it is having its own era. Next, fourth type of learning is reinforcement learning. So reinforcement learning differs from supervised learning in a way that in supervised learning, the training data has the answer key with it, so the model is trained with correct answers itself. Whereas reinforcement learning, there is no answer, but reinforcement agent decides what to do perform the given task. In the absence of training data set, it is bound to learn from the experience. Now the reinforcement learning is totally different from all other learning. It is having some similarities with supervised learning, but we are not 100% sure that it is like supervised learning only, because it is having its own structure and it is having its own way of working. Like in supervised learning, we are having the labeled data. We know what are the answers. We know what are the number of classes present there, okay? But what is there in reinforcement learning? It is about taking suitable actions to maximize reward in a particular situation. So in this type of learning, one agent is present. And what that agent is doing, agent is assigned one task, and what he has to do, agent has to perform that task. And how efficiently that agent is performing the task, based on the basis of that, algorithm has to give rewards to the agent. And if the agent is going to fail for doing the task, then again algorithm has to algorithm or that agent is supposed to find the best possible path or best way to do such task. Okay, so the thing is, in the absence of training data set, it is bound to learn from its experience only. Now see one example. Suppose we have an agent and a reward with many hurdles in between. Now the thing is, agent is supposed to find the best possible path to reach the reward. In this image, we are watching one, or we are seeing one robot here. We can say it as an agent, and we are seeing one diamond here, and some fires are there. So the robot we can say as an agent, the diamond we can say as a reward, and the fire we are seeing here, that we can say as a hurdles. Okay, now it might possible that there are different ways to reach to that diamond for the agent. Okay, so the goal of the robot is to get the reward, that is the diamond, and avoid the hurdles. Hurdles means the fire present there. Okay, now the robot learns by trying all possible paths and then choosing the path which gives him the reward with the minimum hurdles. What the robot will do, robot have to go for every path possible over there, and then he have to learn from itself only that which is the path which will be having lesser hurdles and which will reach me there with minimum time. Okay, so each right step will give the robot a reward, and each wrong step will subtract the reward of the robot, and the total reward will be calculated when it reaches to the final reward, that is diamond. So this is the basic task of reinforcement. Here we are taking one simple example of it, that agent and the diamond, this is the example. But basically the theory behind reinforcement learning is, for every problem there is one agent, and agent has to do some task, and for doing that task there might be number of ways possible, and agent has to find best possible path to reach to that task. So this is the basic theory behind reinforcement learning. Okay, so the above image shows robot, diamond and fire. The goal of the robot is to get the reward, that is diamond, and avoid the hurdles, that are fire. The robot learns by trying all the possible paths and then choosing the path which gives him the reward with the least hurdles. Each right step will give the robot a reward, and each wrong step will subtract the reward of the robot. The total reward will be calculated when it reaches to the final reward, that is diamond. Okay, so this is the one example we can say of reinforcement learning. So main points of reinforcement learning, that we are having input, we are having output, we are having training. Like input should be an initial state from where the model will start. Output, there are many possible outputs as there are variety of solutions to a particular problem. Training is based upon the input. The model will return a state, and the user will decide to reward or punish the model based on output. The model continues to learn. The best solution is decided based on the maximum reward. There are two types of reinforcement learning. First one is positive reinforcement, is defined as when an event occurs due to particular behavior, increases the strength and frequency of the behavior. In other words, it has a positive effect. Okay, so whenever any algorithm increases the strength and the frequency of the behavior of that agent, we can say it is a positive reinforcement learning. And the other side is negative reinforcement. It is defined as the strengthening of behavior because a negative condition is stopped or avoided. So there are some such conditions which can stop working of an agent, or it can avoid the things. So we can see it as a negative reinforcement learning. So there are some applications of reinforcement learning. So it is used in robotics for industrial automation. Reinforcement learning can be used in data processing. It is used in creating training system that provides custom instructions and materials according to the requirement of the students. So these are some practical applications of reinforcement learning. So in our syllabus, what we have to do is we have to work with supervised and unsupervised learning only, because reinforcement learning is we can say is a subject in itself. Okay, whenever we are going to learn reinforcement learning, so it will definitely take 40 to 45 hours to learn. So for that purpose, in our syllabus, the algorithms given to us that are only based on the labeled and unlabeled kind of data. So the thing is, we have to work with supervised and unsupervised learning in our syllabus. Okay, thank you.